Welcome to the Kanawha City Church of Christ. We're glad everyone's here this morning. And we're going to begin by singing a couple of songs. And so please join me in singing When We All Get to Heaven. We'll get to heaven eventually. I hope. All right, here we go. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Holy Spirit, let me see all the things You are, all the things You want me to be. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Holy Spirit, let me see all the things You are, all the things You want me to be. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. All the things You are, all the things You want me to be. Holy Spirit, breathe on me.
Let's pray together. Father God, we're so thankful for this day. We're thankful for the Holy Spirit. We're thankful that Your Spirit is here with us today. And Father, we're just so thankful that we can come together and sing these songs of praise to You. and acknowledge your greatness and to spend time in fellowship with other Christians, other believers. And we pray that all we do this morning is pleasing to you. And we just pray that we can uplift one another and take what we learn here today and apply it to our lives and ultimately reach others with the message of Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Take a minute, and if you see someone you don't know, say hi to them. Let's take just a couple minutes and greet one another. Morning. What's up, George? How are you doing? Hey, Steve. How you doing, bud? All right. The danger is we start talking and then we don't want to sit back down. So I'm going to encourage everybody to make their way back to their seats. And I'm going to ask y'all, we got two songs back to back that are fun to sing. So I'm going to encourage everyone, if it's convenient, to stand and sing the next two songs. Let's continue worship by singing the next two songs. Mm-hmm.
This is the season for a new anointing. This is the season for a fresh outpouring. That the sons and daughters of the King of Glory now arise and shine. That the sons and daughters of the King of Glory may arise and shine as we declare, this is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, I will rejoice, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. In the beginning God created, and for his pleasure all creation sings. Every son and daughter of the King of Glory now arise and shine. Every son and daughter of the King of Glory now arise and shine as we declare, this is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, I will rejoice, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let your glory fill the earth. Let your glory fill the earth. Let your glory fill the earth. Let your glory fill the earth as we declare, this is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, I will rejoice, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. King of glory, fill the earth. King of glory, fill the earth. King of glory, fill the earth. King of glory, fill the earth as we declare, this is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, I will rejoice, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, I will rejoice, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, I will rejoice, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight. He tinted skies with heavenly hue and framed the worlds with his great might.
There is a God, he is alive. In him we live and we survive.
From dust our God created man.
He is our God,
the great I am. There was a long, long time ago a God whose voice the prophets heard. He is the God that we should know, who speaks from his inspired word.
There is a God, he is alive. In him we live and we survive.
From dust our God
created man. He is our God,
the great I am.
Our
God, whose son up on a tree, a life was willing there to give, that he from sin might set men free, and evermore with him could live. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live and we survive.
From dust our God
created man.
He is our God.
The great I am.
Amen. Please be seated. Prior to our communion service, let's sing together Refiner's Fire.
Purify my heart, let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart, let me be as gold, pure gold, refiner's fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my Master, ready to do your will. Purify my heart, cleanse me from within, and make me holy. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin. Deep within, refiner's fire, my heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my Master, ready to do your will, ready to do your will.
Does everyone have a bread and cup? If not, raise your hand and we'll make sure you get one. Okay. We come to that portion of the service that we separate for the Lord's Supper as commanded to us, as we find in 1 Corinthians. And several weeks ago, we had the Olympics. The Olympics consist of individual and team events. Team events, if you happen to be one of the unlucky people that any closing seconds or minutes of your event that you happen to make a mistake and happen to cost your team, you know, that medal or that position, you know, you were then called the scapegoat. We as humans typically use or have the fault of identifying scapegoats in almost any kind of sport that we see that is a team event, even though that is a team event and it takes the entire event in order to either win or lose. This comes really to us from Leviticus. A scapegoat, and the Jewish word for a scapegoat is azazel, which means absolute removal. In Leviticus chapter 16, verses 8 through 10, it tells us, "Then Aaron shall cast lots for the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat on which the Lord's lot fell and offer it as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make atonement upon it and to let it go as a scapegoat into the wilderness. Where the children of Israel, they did this in order to remove or absolute removal of all their sins. In Isaiah, he talks about Jesus in chapter 53, verses 4 through 6. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteem him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So Jesus is our scapegoat. Jesus had all the sins that had up to that point in time and all the sins after that point in time placed on him. So each and every one as individuals, we have sin, and each and every one of us can thank Jesus for removing that sin from us. And that's what he did on the cross for each and every one of us. So as commanded, we participate in the Lord's Supper, and we do this with the two emblems of the bread and the fruit of the vine. So if you would, bow with me as we give thanks for the bread. Thank you, dear Lord, for sending Jesus to remove our sins. And we pray, Lord, that this bread that we may partake of, that represents his body as it hung on the cross, we do so in a manner that is pleasing to you. In Jesus' most holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Likewise, as Jesus hung on the cross, he was pierced in his side by a spear, by a Roman soldier, and blood and water came out. This blood was shed not only through the spear, but also through the nails in his hands and his feet. And the next emblem, the fruit of the vine, represents this blood that was shed for us. So if you would bow with me. Thank you, Lord, for the emblem of the fruit of vine, which helps us to realize and recognize the blood that was shared for us on the tree, on the cross, so many years ago. We pray, Lord, that we may examine ourselves and partake of this fruit of vine, which represents his blood in a manner pleasing to you. In Jesus' most holy name we pray. Amen. This concludes the Lord's Supper. We now have the opportunity to lay by and store in order to continue to work here at Canoa City. Each of us have many blessings, and we have the opportunity to not only the collection plate in the back, but also to give online in a number of ways. So if you would, bow with me as we give thanks for all the blessings that we've received. Our Lord, our God, thank you for the many riches that you give us each and every day, those of the friendships of one another and the fellowship that we are able to have here in your name. We are also thankful, Lord, of the many material things that you give us, our food, our clothing, our shelters. We are thankful, Lord, for the many things that you give us and realize that we would have none of these without you. We pray, Lord, that which we give back to you be used in a manner pleasing to you to further your word, not only here in this community, but around the world. In Jesus' most holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
Kids to make their way out to kids' class. And teachers. And before our lesson this morning, we'll sing together, "They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love."
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, By our love, yes, thou know we are Christians. By our love, we will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come. And all praise to Christ Jesus, His only Son. And all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
I want to take a minute. Obviously, we've had a number of speakers over the last couple months, some better than others. I'll put myself way down there. But it has been a challenge sometimes, but behind every challenge is also an opportunity. And so we have had the opportunity to hear a variety of speakers and a variety of perspectives, and I think that's beneficial to our body. And so we've had speakers from here within our body. We've had some from outside, and then last week my dad came and spoke, and I enjoyed hearing his message as well. We are blessed today to have Rich, a good friend of mine, who's going to bring a lesson this morning, and his wife Mandy. Rich and I have known each other for 20 years, and I could read you his bio, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what I know about Rich. I met Rich about 20 years ago, and honestly, he looks like Jesus. When I see him, I see Jesus. And I'm not talking about his beard. I'm talking about how he lives his life. And so Rich is the preacher at the Kanawha Valley Church, and his wife Mandy, who some of you know her family. She's from Parkersburg, and I think a number of her family worship with my dad at Grand Central in Parkersburg. But we're blessed to have them here this morning. Rich reached out to me. Again, we played basketball. I think that's how we met. But then over the years, we've kind of lost touch and then got back together. And a few years ago, Rich reached out to me and asked me about how did you guys appoint your elders? And it's something that we want to do at our church. And so that kind of rekindled our relationship, and we began spending time together. And I've been blessed by his friendship and blessed by his heart for God and Mandy's heart for God. They are truly servants. And as we started talking, you know, they're a church of, I don't know, roughly the same number as us. And as you guys know, it's a challenge when we try to do things alone, right? And when we want to do a service project, it's tough to do the things that we used to do when we had so many more people. And so we had discussions, and we said, hey, when we're going to do stuff, why don't we do it together? And I said, that sounds great. And so we did VBS together, and I thought it was fantastic. And recently we had the backpack giveaway, and there was a lot of kids blessed. But you know what I learned is that when we serve, the people we serve aren't the ones that are blessed. It's truly the people who serve that are blessed. And it's been a great blessing to me to be able to work together with Rich to reach others with a message of Christ. And so we are truly blessed to have Rich and Mandy with us this morning. He told me, he's like, you know, if you need someone to fill in and come in and preach once in a while, I'm happy to do it. We know you guys are having a challenge right now as you look for another minister. And so he was like, any way we can help you, let us know. And I was like, all right, well, come preach. So he's like, okay. So Rich, I'll ask you to come up and bring our lesson this morning.
Hey, man, good morning, Kanawha City. Good to see you guys. I'm Rich. Man, I'm fired up to be here this morning. You guys are incredible. Like, Chris, thank you so much for the introduction. But getting to know you guys, I've been able to worship with you guys a couple times. We've done some stuff together. I have fallen in love with you guys. My every interaction with the Kanawha City Church of Christ has been amazing. And I just want to thank you guys so much for the warm welcome every time we come to worship and here today. Thank you guys so much. It has been such a joy to get to know you guys. A little intro about us. What do we got? Oh, there we go. Oh, wait, no, that's the video. My bad. Sorry. That's coming next. I'll do that right after this. Sorry, Pete. I'm messing with the sound guy. That's my crew right there. That's me, Big Ugly. It's my beautiful wife, Amanda. She is that beautiful in person. It's not Photoshop. She's right there if you want physical evidence. She's amazing. We've been married for 24 years, coming up in a couple of months. And I have done ministry for almost all of that together. And she is an amazing woman. She is the most godly person I've ever been around. I saw a meme recently. It says, when you put a person with a wild imagination with a person who gets things done, great things happen. And I sent that to her and I said, thank you for being my get things done person. Because she is unbelievable. She is the better part of me and I'm so grateful for her. And she does. Her family comes from a rich history in the Church of Christ. Her grandparents, fathers were preachers, uncles, all that kind of stuff. About 20 years ago, back in the days when we were in Florida, we actually met someone. She was an elder in a church, and somehow it came up, and it turned out her brother was named after Mandy's grandfather, David Blair Myers. And that just huge impact on people's lives, and so rich history there. I, on the other hand, am a pagan. I was converted out of the world. I had very little Christian background. So if I am less orthodox than normal, that's because, you know, I'm just doing what I know. I'm the Gentile, and so that's me. But I love her to death. So great for her. And that's our two daughters. I don't know if it's right or left. The dark-haired one, that's my oldest, Kiara. She just finished her freshman year at Radford University. Amazing young woman. Oh, my goodness. And then that's Mia, the blonde. And she is a senior at George Washington High School this year. If you go see any of the games, she's the twirler out there and all that kind of stuff. She's amazing. I like my family. They're a good crew. Yeah, man, that's a little bit about us. We've been with the Kanawha Valley Church. I'll share a little bit about our church after the video. First off, I just wanted to thank you guys. One of the things that I've fallen in love with you guys is you are insanely generous in giving. We don't even talk about things, and you guys volunteer. A couple of things you guys have done. When we said we wanted to do VBS, you guys showed up in force. In the past, when we do VBS, we have like little snacks. You know what I mean? We give some goldfish away, that kind of thing, right? We asked Kanawha City to do it. It was like a whole menu. It was unbelievable. The lady showed up in force. It was so good. And it was such a great VBS. We do something each year where we do a special contribution to support missions all over the world and domestically and locally. And our goal as a church was to collect $15,000. We're a church of around 50, so that's a pretty lofty goal. You know what I mean? We pray about it. We go for it. And this year, with a goal of $15,000, we collected $13,500. And I told Chris, and I was all fired up. I was like, we did it. He said, well, tell you what, we'll make up the difference. And you guys generously donated the difference to where there's missionaries in India right now because of your generosity, because of you guys. We talked about doing the backpack thing together and working together to do that. And Chris calls me, and I'll tell the whole story in a minute. But you donated backpacks. You came Friday night and put things together, and it was such an incredible weekend. Right now, I want to show you a video from the weekend. Should I back up? Right now.
Celebration. Yeah-ho! All right.
Amen. So again, thank you guys so much for all you did to make this week happen. All right, look over in Ephesians chapter 3 together. Let's get into the Bible. A little bit about our church real quick. So we began the Kanawha Valley Church about 12 years ago. About 20 of us, crazy yahoos, moved to Charleston with a desire to see a church planted here with discipling and grow and really impact the campuses in Huntington, at Marshall University, and here in Charleston. And it has been a wild ride. In our first 7 years, we saw 65 people baptized into Christ. It was super fun and thrilling and fast-paced and awesome. We saw the church grow, and then we bought a building over in South Hills. God blessed us with an amazing facility, and that was around 2019. And at that point, I was burned out. And I decided, I said, look, I need a sabbatical. I went to the board. I said, I need a break. I'm burned out. And they graciously gave me a sabbatical. Well, the first Sunday of my sabbatical, guess where I came to worship? Right here with you guys. And so I walk in, I don't know anybody, I'm like, all right, here we go. And then all of a sudden I see this one crazy yahoo running around, doing all sorts of stuff. And it was Chris. I was like, wait, I know that guy from basketball and PTA. I know that guy right there. And he came over and he stood next to me and he's holding a mic and singing. And we don't do it like that. We do it a little differently. But I thought, I don't know if you want to stand next to me with a mic and singing. That's a bad idea. But I was blown away to see his heart for God and his desire to serve in all these different ways. And so... it was incredible, and it was an incredibly restorative time after that sabbatical. And so we come back to ministry, re-energized in 2020, and guess what happened? COVID happened. And to be honest, we've survived the last 4 years. So we're coming out, and you know. And then this week, we took a six-week sabbatical, or eight-week sabbatical, and really had a time to re-energize and refocus and move the church forward. Now, you guys have the unfortunate privilege of being the church that I get to preach to, where I've been studying the book of Ephesians for a long time now. And I have like a whole series ready, but you guys, we only have one sermon. So you get a whole series in one sermon. Are you ready? Hey, I apologize ahead of time. Amen. Look at Ephesians chapter 3. In verse 20, we're going to start reading. It says in verse 20, "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." That's a great verse, isn't it? It's kind of cool. I have a great friendship. Some of you guys may know him. His name is Brad Strum. He's the pulpit minister for the Morgantown Church of Christ. And I texted him. I told him, "I'm preaching here today. Please pray for me." And this very verse is the verse he texted me back to encourage me. I was like, "No way, that's the verse I'm preaching on tomorrow." Isn't that cool? Guys, this is an amazing verse, right? We tend to focus on the prayer part of it. "Now to him who's able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine." That's a good purpose for it. You know what I mean? We pray God does big things. But it says here, glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Glory in the church. That's a big deal, isn't it? Church, we are meant to bring glory, God's glory, into the world. In the beginning, God created humanity. He created us in his image. His desire was that we would image bear, that we would reflect his glory in the world. Amen? That we would reflect it to one another and experience God's glory in one another as we acted and related to one another like him. And how did we do with that? We butchered it. By Genesis 3, we made it three chapters. And we blew that thing, right? After that, he said, "Okay, my next plan is to work through Israel, to establish Abraham and bless the nations through that." In Isaiah chapter 43, talking about Israel, he said, "Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory." Israel was created to reflect God's glory to the world. You with me? And yet, they butchered it. And so now, what is God's plan to reflect his glory to the world? We are church. It's us. We're the plan. We're God's plan A. We're his plan B. We're his plan C. We're kind of a big deal. You with me? That's us, church. Glory in the church. This is God's plan to reveal his nature and his plan and his heart to the entire world. We're a big deal. None of us in person, but collectively. When church does church as God designed church, his glory is revealed. Now here's where we're going to take a minute, and I'm going to do my whole series in 5 minutes. Amen? That's a challenge. Hold me to it, all right? In 5 minutes, start throwing stuff at me. All right, so what's going on here in Ephesians that leads up to this bold declaration in Ephesians chapter 3? Well, he starts out in Ephesians 1, super famous passage, 1 through 14, where he explains their identity, what Jesus has done for them, and why, because they're in Christ, they are different in the role that they will play. Okay, in 15 through 22, he says a prayer, but there's an important part of this prayer. I'm terrible at slides, guys. I'm sorry. Yeah, I was supposed to show that before. Yep, I'm the worst ever. My wife said, "You should probably put some lines in there about that or something." But I didn't even put the slide in. Amen. In verse 1, in chapter 1, verse 18a, as he's praying, he says something really significant. He says, "I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened." Okay? The eyes of your heart may be enlightened. So here he is echoing what happened when Elisha and Gehazi, and they're surrounded by the armies. You remember that story in 2 Kings, where 2 Kings 6, where he said Elijah prays, "Open his eyes, Lord, that he may see." And then all of a sudden the servant can see the chariots of fire all over, that those who are with us are greater than those who are with them. What he's trying to do is he's trying to capture their imaginations. He's trying to help them have a different worldview. So along with their identity as Christians, he wanted them to engage a worldview of, of how the world is set up and what our role as Jesus' followers are in this world. Ephesians is apocalyptic literature. Apocalyptic means to unveil, to kind of pull back the veil between the spiritual realm and the physical realm to help us see how they interrelate. You with me? That the spiritual realities are as important as the physical realities. The things that affect our five senses, that's how we interact with the world. He's trying to awaken a sixth sense, a sense that is sensitive to the realities of the spiritual realm and the role they play in the physical realm. Amen, church? Well, he continues. He goes on and he prays that that they may know the hope to which they were called, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. Here again, he taps in on his holy people, the church, and the incomparably great power. Remember he talked about that in Ephesians 3? So he's riffing. He's trying to help us understand. You're a big deal, and there's a lot of power available to us. Amen, church? It's a big deal. He continues on. In verse 20 and 21, he says, that power, this power that's available to us, is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked. Here, Paul introduces a couple of concepts. One, that Jesus has won this victory that gives us salvation. But not only that, he is seated at the right hand of God. He is now the reigning king of the universe. And he has brought low all of the rules and authorities, powers and dominions. He's introducing the concept of the spiritual beings that are involved in the world. He goes on in chapter 2, he says it this way. Oh, I butchered this, didn't I? I told you guys, I warned you ahead of time. No, not that. Look at this, man, I'm so bad at this. You would think after 20 years of being a preacher, I'd be better with keynote. I am not. Wait for it. This does not count against my 5 minutes, to be clear. This is a separate 5 minutes. Just getting back to the scriptures we're supposed to be looking at. Oh, I guess I didn't put it in there. Look at this. Either it's not there. All right. But in Ephesians 2, here's what he says. Right after that prayer, he says, as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. He introduces the concept that there are spiritual forces that are trying to lead humanity away from serving God and honoring God, away from bringing glory to God. And we as the church, as we submit to King Jesus, we are the answer. Amen, church? Does that make sense? That was my 5 minutes on the whole book of Ephesians. All right? Now let's look at 2 points for this morning. Point number one, we desperately need each other. So right after that declaration of glory in the church, what's the first thing he says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1? It says, as a prisoner of the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. The first three chapters, as he lays out this worldview and this identity that we're to have, this worldview of these forces that are trying to destroy humanity, and we being the answer as the church, and we being empowered by God to overcome that, right? He lays all that out. There are zero admonitions in the first three chapters of the book of Ephesians. From chapter 4 on, there are 35 admonitions on how we're to live that out, how we're supposed to glory in the church. You know what the first one is? Be unified. Be unified. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient. Bear with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. The greatest way we glory in the church, that we bring God's glory into the world, is by being unified. We sang a beautiful song about this right beforehand, right? We are one in the Spirit. Right? Man, when we are unified, glory. Glory in the church. Jesus says this, the world will know you're my disciples, right? What's amazing for me is that in order to be unified, what he says is we have to be completely humble. One of the things I've been super moved by at Kenosha City Church is the humility of your leadership. Chris, Tom, and Tom, and Carson, and you know, as we've gotten to know each other and built a relationship, I appreciate him saying, I'm the one who initiated asking about elders. But they're the ones who said, man, we'd be better working together. We should really start working together and doing things. That was their humility that initiated that. That wasn't me. And it was them saying, man, let's be unified. Let's do what this verse says. That led to God working in amazing ways. A couple of the cool things that maybe you don't know happened. So we did VBS together, right? And you guys, like I said, knocked it out of the park, right? Well, there was one family who came, who the husband came and he son, and he's been around our church for a while. He generally would just come to the fun things we do. You know what I mean? Super Bowl parties, you know, that kind of stuff, right? But never to anything spiritual. But he brought his son to VBS. Well, he would hang out the whole time, and we just thought, you know, he's being a good dad. He's watching out for his son or whatever, you know. Well, after the second day, I said, hey, man, it's great to see you. How's it going? You know, I said, so, you know, do you get into the Bible much? Just, you know, basic conversation. He said, no, my son has been asking me all kinds of questions. I was not raised around any kind of Christianity. So I've been sitting in the Bible lessons in VBS so I could learn the Bible. He sat in the lessons, learned. He started to study the Bible, right? He's been reading his Bible. He started getting together with some of the guys and studying the Bible. But all of that started with us working together to do VBS. He's really close to getting baptized because of us getting together and doing VBS together, right? The back to school carnival, a couple of cool stories. You know, we had teens that came and served from all over the place at it. Well, some of the teens are disciples of Jesus, some of them aren't, and we had them get up and share on Sunday at church last Sunday about their experience, and we thought they were going to share like, yeah, it was good to serve the kids, they were cute, and all that kind of stuff, right? Two of them came up and said, can we share what happened last night? You're not going to believe this. So basically, two of the girls, this is 1:30 in the morning, two of the girls that are disciples of Jesus were sitting upstairs, laying in bed, and there's like shadows of the shades on the ceiling, right? And they're sitting having a conversation about how hard it is to understand God's timing and how they wish God would give clear signs so that they knew what God's timing was, right? So one of the girls literally says, it would be so cool if like right now God just showed us a sign, if he just made it dark. As soon as she did that, it went completely dark. Which is pretty crazy, right? That's only half the story. Upstairs, two girls who are not disciples of Jesus were having a conversation. They came to it, they wanted to serve, but they have not wrestled with their own faith. And they were having a conversation about how we just don't know about God, and I don't know, like it's so hard. I wish, it's hard to tell his timing. I wish he would just show me clearly what he wants me to do. Should I study the Bible? Should I get baptized? They're having this whole conversation for like 45 minutes. One of the girls says, you know what? God saved my life by showing me his timing, and he will show you his timing when it's, you know, whatever, when it's his time. As soon as she said, he will show you it's his timing, the two girls came running upstairs, having had that same thing happen, talking about God's timing, and telling that story the moment those two girls were having a conversation about God's timing. You with me? Like, God worked through the backpack drive and all that kind of stuff to serve the community, but he works in people's hearts. He works through the church when we're unified and we work together. You know, I'll be honest with you guys. I am very humbled to be here preaching this morning. Our family of churches has not always been great at this part of unity. We used to all be together. We come from you guys. You're our parents. We're like the little kids of the family, if you would, right? But we were not humble. We were not gentle. We were not patient. We were arrogant and triumphalist. And we did not embrace Ephesians chapter 4. And a large part of why we're separate is because of our sin and our arrogance and our pride. And I wasn't there for it. I was converted way later, but I apologize for that. That wasn't right. We have one of the leaders in our church that was around during that time. He recently wrote in a book, "Our break with the churches of Christ was at best a mistake, at worst a grievous sin." So I don't speak for everybody, but I kind of speak for everybody to say sorry. We were wrong in that. And what we're doing working together is a really good thing. And there's glory in the church. The world sees Jesus in greater ways when we work together than when we get tribal and, you know what I mean? This is way better, guys. And I thank Chris, I thank Tom, Carson, and the whole crew. Thank you guys for being far more spiritual than we are, far wiser than we are, and initiating this whole thing. Amen? Unity with you guys brings glory to God in the world. My second point, what time is it? What time do you guys go to? This will be a fast point. How about that? My second point, we desperately need each other to mature. In the same way, let's read. In verse 7, it says, "But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it." Jump down to verse 11. It says, "So Christ himself gave apostles and the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up as each part does its work." You know, the call here, Paul paints a picture of a community that is continually being transformed more and more into the likeness of Christ. Amen? That's us. That's what God is doing in us. He is transforming us all the time. For us as a church, we created, to help us with this, is this 5 stages of spiritual maturity. And the idea here is someone who is not in Christ yet, as it says in Ephesians chapter 2, they are dead in their sins. And so they're dead. Then somebody, through faith and allegiance to Jesus and baptism, they are born again. They are an infant. Now, just like in real life, infants require a lot of attention. They require a lot of work and care. So too does someone who's new in the faith. But the goal is that that person matures, right? Then they go through childhood, where they're able to do some things, but there's still a lot of direction needed, right? Then they become an adult. An adult is self-sustaining. They can take care of themselves, but they're not quite ready to take care of somebody else yet, right? We have a 17 and a 19-year-old. Our 17-year-old's like, "I'm not ready to adult yet." I mean, she takes care of herself, but she's not quite ready. She's going through that process, amen? And then you have a spiritual parent. That's somebody who actually takes care of other people, is able to take care of other people. We see this in Hebrews 5. "Though by now you ought to be teachers, you still need someone to take care of you, right? So this is the idea. We want every disciple to mature through all the stages and get to the point where they are spiritual parents. Like we talked about, for us as a church, what we learned is we were great at making disciples. We were not great at maturing disciples. And so we had people that were stagnant. We had people that would walk away. We had people that weren't stepping into ministry, really. And so we decided this is an area where we want to be transformed. We want to grow to be more like Jesus's ministry. And so we want to change this. I as a leader had to change. I am really good at doing ministry. Like I'll go, I'll run, I work hard, I do it, and we'll baptize people. But I'm not good at coaching other people to do it. And so I'm having to learn. According to this, leadership is to equip God's people for works of service, not run around and do all the works of service. Amen? And so we're changing as a church. We're really trying to grow and mature how we do what we do as a church. The point, we're continually being matured to be more and more the likeness of Christ. Well, how about you, Kanawha City? What are the areas where you as a church feel like you're maturing and you're growing? What are the areas where you want to tackle and go, man, we want to be more like Jesus in this way. We want to do church more like Jesus in this way. Paul says in Philippians chapter 3, right? I want to know Christ, all this stuff, but I've not yet taken hold of it, right? One thing I do, forget what's behind, go for what is ahead. Right? And then he goes on, he says, all who are mature should take such a view of things. In other words, if we're mature, there should be a constant self-assessment, a constant, like, how am I doing? Am I really maturing? As an individual, am I a spiritual parent? As a community, are there areas where we need to grow and serve Jesus in greater ways? I'll tell you one thing, man, you guys have a lot of maturity. Like, we're a young church. We would covet all the Bible knowledge that's in this room and the maturity, the years of marriage and parenting that's in this room. Man, you guys are amazing. But is that being used for spiritual parenting and taking care of other people? You have so much to offer the church. Brothers and sisters, God's plan is for his church to bring his character into this world. Amen? In order to do so, we desperately need each other. We've got to be unified. We've got to be connected, close, work together. We need each other. And we desperately need each other to mature. The church has got to continue to mature and grow in how we engage in the world. When we do this, we'll see Ephesians chapter 3 fulfilled. Now to him who's able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
This morning, in just a moment, we'll have a closing song, and we'll give you the opportunity, if you have any needs, to come forward and as we stand and sing. Let's sing A Common Love.
A common love for each other, a common gift to the Savior, a common bond holding us to the Lord, a common strength when we're weary, a common hope for tomorrow, a common joy in the truth of God's word. A common love for each other, a common gift to the Savior, a common bond holding us to the Lord. A common strength when we're weary, a common hope for tomorrow, a common joy in the truth of God's word.
Please. Please bow with me. Dear God, we're so thankful to be here today. Not because of the building, not because we get dressed up, and it is our habit that we form, Lord, but because we fellowship with one another, because we focus and worship you, Lord. Wherever two or more are gathered, there you are with us, Lord. And we come here not for the building, but as a church. Lord, and wherever that church may be, whether together or separate, Lord, we're just thankful that we can focus on you and your message, Lord. We're thankful to have the visitors we have today, Lord, to hear the lessons that we've heard today, Lord. And we pray that we take it to heart, Lord, that we open our heart, our minds, our soul to listen to your message, that as we continue through this week, Lord, that we focus on you not to be perfect, not because anything that we do will save us, God, but because you have saved us, Lord, that we continue to do your good works because of the amazing sacrifice and the amazing gift you've given us, God. We love you, and we pray that as we continue through this week, again, we focus on you and your message, that we focus on maturing in your word and as disciples. We're so thankful for everything you've given us, God. We pray all this in your son's name. Amen.